Hi, my name is Patrick Uiterhoeven. So I will talk about how we did the upgrade process from PostgreSQL with table partitioning to PostgreSQL with Timescale DB. And in the meantime, we also did an upgrade of our Zabbix installation. So just to give you an idea who OpenFuture is, so it's a privately owned company based in Nossegem. It's in Belgium. It's not too far from Brussels. OpenFuture was founded in 2009 by two people, Danny and Nico. But our focus is exclusively on open source. So our focus goes completely to the open source market. We have some partnerships, but we are not limited to those partnerships. And we are, of course, we are also official training partner for Zabbix, Bacala, Puppet, and a few others. To give you an idea who I am, so that's my name, but you know it already. I'm an open source consultant, and I'm also a certified Zabbix trainer. I have, of course, certain interests, and those are monitoring, of course, but also Ansible, as a Linux, and PostgreSQL. Over the years, I've written a few books from Zabbix, so if you're interested, the latest one is the Zabbix 4 Network Monitoring, which was originally written by Richards, an ex-employee of Zabbix. I did the rework for the 4.0 version. Before we start, some notes. There are probably different solutions to solve this problem. Not probably, there are many different solutions to solve the problem of partitioning and to migrate to Timescale DB. The solution that worked for us might maybe not be the best for you, but for us, this was the solution that fits the best for us. So that's why we took this migration path. Our needs, to give you an idea, we wanted to preserve the history. History is important for us. We don't care much about the trending. It's nice to have, but we can live without it. In our case, it's mostly reporting important, and the history is something that we like to have, because 1 week or 2 weeks of history is something that you want to have to keep, because you want to go and look back in your history what happened. Trending is nice for file systems, but besides that, we don't really care about it. We were running 4.0 of Zabbix, and we wanted to migrate to 4.4 because there were some features that we liked, like, for example, in the pre-processing, there were some nice things that we liked. So this was the idea. We had table partitioning already, and we wanted to migrate to Timescale DB because Timescale DB is, as you know, now a supported feature in Zabbix. So it's the only database that you can partition that is officially supported by Zabbix. So that was a reason for us to migrate and to do the upgrade. Also, one of the things that we wanted to do was to upgrade Postgres 10 to 11, as version 11 is more or less the standard in our company. So we wanted to migrate to 11 as well. Of course, we wanted to limit the migration time, as our infrastructure is highly dependent on Zabbix. We can go down in our setup, but we have to tell the developers that we will go down for our upgrades. Because when we deploy machines, everything is automatically registered in Zabbix, so we cannot just tell the developers, okay, you can migrate everything or you can deploy everything, and we will add it back later in Zabbix. So that is why we have to limit our downtime, or we have to tell them that there will be a certain period where they cannot deploy. So first of all, how did we upgrade Zabbix? Upgrading Zabbix is quite easy. You don't have to do anything for it. You just replace the binaries. Replace, of course, the repo. The first thing that you have to do, of course, is replace the repo. Normally, your configuration is preserved, at least on CentOS. I don't know for other operating systems. I suppose it's the same. So normally you can just upgrade your binaries and you're good to go. The upgrade from the database is done automatically, as you know, by Zabbix, so that is something you don't have to worry. Of course, we did the tests on a test machine with a copy of our database, just to be sure that you don't run into any issues. So this is something you should not really worry about. Then, of course, the Timescale DB part. We already had a database that was partitioned. So we were looking at how can we move data from partition tables to Timescale DB. Like I already said, there was not really a need to preserve the trending. So what we did was we decided to drop the trending tables completely and just go without the trending, because there was no need to keep it, and it would also migrate much faster, because you don't have to convert everything from trending. So this was the first decision that we made. Another thing that we did was, like 2 weeks before the migration, we stopped all the database scripts. We had database scripts that were copying all the data to the partition tables. So in that case, the data was preserved completely on disk already, which made things more easy to migrate to TimescaleDB, because if you don't have the partitioning already, then you can just use the scripts that are in TimescaleDB. So in that case, we just dropped all the tables later on. So the day of the migration, we only had to drop the history data in the partition tables together with our trending data. And then we had like a normal PostgreSQL database with a normal Zabbix setup. To give you some tips for the migration, there are other solutions that you can use. TimescaleDB, for example, has tools like TimescaleDB Parallel Copy that you can use. It will copy everything to the correct place. So it's a command line utility that uses parallelization for PostgreSQL. So this is an option, but we never used it. In our case, we just went for the easy way. You could write your own scripts to move data to the correct location. That's another option. If you like, you can write your own scripts and then still PostgreSQL to copy everything from the partition tables to the correct location. Those are other ways, but you have to write your own scripts, of course. Some things that we noticed when we were installing TimescaleDB, of course, was that TimescaleDB has its own tunes, for example, to tune the database. You have TimescaleDB tune. It's something on the command line that will check your configuration, and it will tell you, okay, from our point of view, you're better to go with these and these parameters. But one thing that we noted was when you run this tool, it will try to change your original PostgreSQL.com file. It will ask you a few things. It will tell you, are you agree or do you not agree? But at the end, it will overwrite your PostgreSQL.configuration file without telling you that it will do this. It will make a backup, but yeah, of course, your PostgreSQL conf file is modified. So be careful. Yeah, thanks. Also, it will not look in files you have included in your original PostgreSQL.com file. For example, we have a PostgreSQL.com file, and it has an include file with all our changes. So it complains that it cannot find the module, but the module is there. So this is something that you have to keep in mind as well. The TimescaleDB tune will also think that your database is on a dedicated machine. So don't just copy and apply its suggestions. It will try to tune your memory, but it will go out from the idea that your database is on a dedicated machine. So if you have Zabbix installed on it and a few other things, then keep in mind that those parameters are not the parameters for you to go with. There is a chance that you will encounter errors in your PostgreSQL logs, like this, for example, that you're out of shared memory, and it will tell you to increase the MAC logs per transaction. This is something that is normal because TimescaleDB relies heavily on the partitioning for scaling time series workloads. And it has an impact on the log management. So it will log much more, and you have to increase this parameter. So something that you have to keep in mind as well. This is an example when you run the TimescaleDB tuning parameter. So you have to give up the path of your configuration, and then it will try to read your configuration file, your parameters, and it will propose something new. And in the end, it will just tell you, is this okay, yes or no, and then it will write the configuration file and create a backup in /tmp. Then there was the part for upgrading to Postgres 11 from 10. And also here it can be done in many different ways, but the way that we did was on the machine itself. You can, for example, do some replication, you can create database dumps and then upload it again in a new database, but there are more easy ways to do this. So we wanted to do it as fast as possible. Some downtime was acceptable for us as we were already down for the Zabbix migration and the TimescaleDB migration. And it had to be done on the same hardware in our case, so that's why we chose to use the pgupgrade command. Pgupgrade is a nice tool that you can run to upgrade your database, and it has the advantage that you can do it without having to create a dump from your database. Normally, when you upgrade your database, you will create a dump, install a new database, upload the dump, and it will take a lot of time. So with pgupgrade, you can circumvent this. We only had to install a new version, so the binary is for PostgreSQL 11 next to PostgreSQL 10. And with pgupgrade, you can point to the old data folder and the new data folder. And then it will move the data from one place to the other place. And then it will run the upgrade. Since we already had dropped our trending data, we only had to migrate the history, so this was already a huge win for us in time. Now, if you run the PG upgrade command, you can use a few parameters, and the first one is the minus B to specify the old data folder. Then you have the capital B, that is for the new data folder, and then you have the option minus K, and the minus K option is a nice one because it will use hard links. So it's when you have the old data folder and the new data folder, if you don't specify the minus K, it will try to copy all the data from one location to the other. With the minus K, it will use the hard links, and you don't have to copy anything. It will just link your data to the new path. So your upgrade goes very quick, and you don't really have to worry. You can even check it with the minus check option to see if everything will run like it's supposed to run. And then if it fails, you can fix it. Or if it doesn't fail, you can just go with the migration. It only takes a few minutes to migrate your database. Some tips for TimescaleDB. Don't forget that there is an extension. So remember that you need to upgrade it also when you upgrade your database. So the TimescaleDB extension needs to be upgraded from time to time. Don't forget to add the extension, of course, in your PostgreSQL.com file. On our case, we add it in an extra file that is included in the PostgreSQL.com file. This makes it more easy to see what changes you have made for TimescaleDB and eventually other plugins. The parameters for tuning can be kept in a configuration file, timescaledb.conf, so this is what we did. Just to give you an idea about the specs, we didn't do any database testing before and afterwards, but just to give you an idea, we are running about 2,000 hosts, 270,000 items, and about 96,000 triggers. The machine has about 1,700 values per second, and we are running this on just a simple machine with like 2 CPUs and 4 SSD drives for the database. We didn't have any issues before, and with TimescaleDB, we didn't notice any issues afterwards. The only thing is that we don't have to use scripts anymore. Everything is now done without any need for scripts. And we have the certainty that if there is a problem, that we now have the support from Zabbix. Because it's an official supported plugin. So this was for our case the most important part to migrate. So I don't know if you have any questions.
So thank you, first of all. Quick question for you is, did you encounter some? You said you don't had any issues before, which mm-hmm. is good, and you didn't had any issues after, which is even better.
Yeah.
So did you encounter some from your feeling some performance gains in terms of maybe when you use the web interface or so? I mean, the machine was great with SSDs, weight 10. Mm-hmm. So, but could you from your
like I said, we had no issues before in performance. The machine is, hope, properly tuned for it. So there was no need to migrate for anything just besides the support from Zabbix. This was for us the way to just migrate. And I cannot say that we have better systems now that are more smooth, because before there was no issue at all. So it's just now we are sure that the Zabbix database is running and that TimescaleDB is doing the partitioning for us. We don't have to verify if there is an issue with scripts, etc.
So. And then also on one of the slides, you mentioned this minus K parameter, mm-hmm. where you said it would prevent copying.
Yeah.
So that would really, so if one is going to do the migration, you would recommend?
I would highly recommend it, because else it's the same like taking a dump and uploading a dump, because it has to move the data from your database. So with the minus K, it will just make hard links and it doesn't have to do anything. It only does the upgrade on your database, and that's it. So,
thank you very much.
Hi, thanks for the presentation. And I have a couple of questions. First of all, how big is your database in terms of disk size, disk space occupied? And how long did it actually took from the moment you said that now it's downtime, it starts the downtime, and until it's up and running again?
The database, of course, we resized it because we dumped all the training. Normally, it's around 300-350 gigs. The total time, I have to think, because we did some other migrations as well at the same moment, but it took about less than 2 hours, I think, to make everything.
As a data point, I've done PG upgrades on 80 terabyte databases within 3 minutes. So with PG upgrade with the minus K option, you can really go fast.
Thanks. Okay, thank you.